This video is sponsored by Blinkist. The demand for mined metals used for things like construction materials and battery packs for EVs are set to keep increasing exponentially in the coming years. But metals are in limited supply, and we're quickly running out of good ores to mine them from, leading to larger amounts of tailings and other waste from the mining industry, as well as higher costs for things that we use every day. But what if the solution to all this was to turn farmers into agro-miners? Yes, mining for metals and other materials by growing crops. I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci. Metals are an essential part of our modern world. They're a part of all infrastructure, and they're in most of the products and things that we use every day. We mine over 3 billion metric tons of iron every year, making it the most widely mined metal in the world by far. But iron wouldn't be nearly as popular if it weren't for other alloying elements like nickel or carbon, making these elements equally important. Throw some carbon into iron and you get steel, which is vastly more interesting, but iron is still at the core of it all. So let's focus a bit on nickel. Nickel is an often hidden but essential part of many of the sustainability technologies that we cover right here on this channel. You probably remember from previous episodes that nickel is an important part of lithium-ion batteries that power our laptops, mobile devices, and EVs, where it can make up to 80% of the cathode material. Every year, we mine 2.7 million tons of fresh nickel to cover the increasing demand, of which almost 70% ends up in stainless steel, 11% in batteries, 6% in electroplating, and the rest in other uses. This means that we use almost 300,000 tons of nickel every year for batteries alone, and the demand is set to increase approximately 20-fold in the next 30 years. So, unless other technologies manage to replace lithium ion in EVs and other mobile applications, we'll definitely need additional sources of metals like nickel if we were to meet this new demand. Now, no matter how sustainable their applications are, materials like nickel are only as sustainable as the processes used to make them, with hydrogen being a great example, as we've explored in recent videos about red hydrogen that I suggest checking out here. In the case of metals, these have to be mined from the ground, and the ores have to be transported, crushed, and submitted to different metallurgical processes to extract the pure metal or its compounds. Even though we could power some of these things with green energy, the mining part, yeah, it's gonna be dirty. Mining destroys the soil and pollutes air and water, and so it produces massive amounts of waste called tailings, all of which need to be managed. But what if there was a way to turn mining's negative effects into something good, effectively cleaning up one of the dirtiest parts of metal production? Well, there is, and it's called agro-mining. Agro-mining, sometimes called metal farming, is just what the name implies. I mean, isn't it so obvious? Using agriculture and plants to extract minerals like metals from the ground, and then harvesting the plant to extract those metals from the biomass. This is a relatively new yet simple idea that uses very special plants technically called hyperaccumulators, aka metal hoarders, which have the unique ability to accumulate certain metals like nickel or manganese in their sap and leaves to a much higher concentration than normal. The concentration can be hundreds of thousands of times higher than what normal plants can tolerate, reaching a staggering 25% dry weight, compared to normal leaves and average plants that usually get around 0.0005%. in dry weight. And speaking of taking something valuable and concentrating it, is a perfect segue to tell you about one of my favorite services that I think you have to check out. Blinkist is a time-saving app that's basically mission-critical here at Tuba Da Vinci. It's a catalog of over 5,500 nonfiction books and podcasts that help you understand the most important ideas in just 15 minutes. It's like having a researcher and assistant in your pocket, and it helps me find new ideas and concepts for our videos, like this blink on the chemistry book, broken out into 13 key chemistry breakthroughs from gunpowder to graphene that I went through on a recent drive. I don't have time to read every book I want to, but with Blinkist, I can cast a wide net, learn a ton, and figure out where I should dive deeper. Another great blink I've listened to recently was on A Beginner's Guide to Energy that's given me quite a few ideas for future videos. But it's not just science. With topics ranging from philosophy, productivity, politics, and leadership, they have something for everyone. And with Blinkist Connect, you can even share your Blinkist premium plan with a friend or family member for free. You can even compare notes and share recommendations. Become who you want to be in 2023. Whether it's a better parent, a smarter communicator, a more impactful team member, or a savvier investor, it's all a 15-minute blink away with Blinkist. Get 25% off Blinkist Premium and enjoy 2 memberships for the price of 1. Start your 7-day free trial by clicking the link in the description. More importantly, metal concentrations in hyperaccumulators can be several times higher than the original soil, making the plant itself a better source of metal than the soil where it grows, and better, in fact, than most commercially viable ores. For example, high-grade nickel ores usually have only a little over 2% nickel, but bio-ores from nickel hyperaccumulators can reach over 10 times that concentration. These plants store heavy metals in isolated compartments inside their cells as a defense mechanism. Heavy metals are toxic, so eat them and you'll be sick. So how does agro-mining really work? Well, both the theory and the practice behind agro-mining are pretty straightforward. First, we start by carefully selecting the right hyperaccumulator species. There are literally thousands of known hyperaccumulators for different metals and minerals, which grow in different climates and soil conditions. Second, we plant these hyperaccumulators in metal-rich degraded lands like those found in abandoned mines, ultramafic laterite soil, or in mine tailings. Once the plants reach maturity comes the harvest. This gives us a metal-rich biomass, but it's not quite ready for metal extraction yet. We first need to dry and incinerate them so we can get a high-grade metal bio-ore in the form of an ash. The bio-ore is finally processed into pure metal salts and other compounds, or the pure metal of different industrial applications through different thermo or hydrometallurgical processes. And the waste? Well, in most cases, that can be put back into the soil as fertilizer. It seems to me that agro-mining is such a no-brainer. Anyone with experience in farming and with the right guidance could easily start producing metal ores from any of these plants, even in soils you would normally consider worthless. This opens the opportunity for a new source of income for farmers who live in or near places with ultramafic or serpentine soils. But there's so much more that agro-mining brings to the table compared to traditional mining and traditional agriculture. First, with agro-mining, we don't need to mine the soil and transport thousands of pounds of rock miles away where we need to use vast amounts of energy to crush the stones into thin powder before processing. Dry or fresh biomass is much easier to chop into smaller bits for making processing much less energy intensive. Second, the dry biomass itself is a source of energy that we can harness when we incinerate it, further offsetting the cost of energy to produce the metal. Third, and this is particularly important, agro-mining produces a pure metal or pure metal compound than traditional mining, allowing its direct use in metal catalyst production for the chemical industry, and even as metal oxides for battery manufacturing, adding more value to the crop. Fourth, as mentioned before, these crops can grow in low-quality soils which aren't fit for farming or commercially viable for traditional mining. For example, some nickel hyperaccumulators can grow in ultramafic laterite soils found in places like the Philippines, Indonesia, and New Caledonia, where nickel content is below 1%, making it uneconomical for mining. But with concentrations too high for most other crops to grow, making it useless for traditional farming. This is probably the biggest benefit to everyday people like farmers who can use their know-how to add value to land that would otherwise be idle, while providing income for themselves and their families at the same time. Another benefit is that agro-mining can help with soil rehabilitation after strip mining. This makes it doubly attractive for mining companies who get more value from the mine for longer while at the same time cleaning their operation and integrating it into their circular economy. Finally, we can also use agro-mining to suck out heavy metals and recycle metal-rich waste from different industries by simply growing the right hyperaccumulators in these areas. By now, you're probably wondering, if this is so great, then why haven't I heard about it before? Why aren't there agro-mining companies all over the place cleaning after mining companies and turning out a decent profit while they're at it? Well, it turns out, even though agro-mining sounds great in theory, it's still a very recent idea and it hasn't reached commercial scale yet. The whole movement was set in motion because of the current rising trend in nickel demand. A couple decades ago, this wasn't the case. We could easily increase production to meet demand without a hiccup. Today, with the renewable energy and the EV revolution, things look quite different. But that's not to say that all this is just a theory or coming from a lab. In fact, one research group has taken one step out of the lab and into the field with a European spinoff company called Life Agromine. The company has been working on several pilot farms trying to determine the economic feasibility of nickel agro-mining in different European countries like Spain, Germany, and Albania. The results from these longest-running projects were recently reported after 15 years of gathering data in Poske, Albania. They used a local variety of nickel hyperaccumulator called Odontargena calcitica, and under optimal conditions were able to get a maximum of 425 pounds of nickel per hectare in the form of a very valuable salt called ammonium nickel sulfate hexahydrate, or ANSH. Let's go with ANSH. This salt can be used directly for nickel electroplating or as a stock material for pure nickel metal manufacturing. So let's see how much value Life Agromine can get out of these seemingly unfertile lands. ANSH contains 14.9% nickel, so 425 pounds of nickel would be equivalent to about 2,850 pounds of ANSH. Cheap ammonium nickel sulfate sourced in India costs between $5.50 and $11 per pound. For a technical grade salt, By technical grade, I mean 85 to 90% pure. So nickel produced in each hectare of Life Agromine's metal farm is worth anywhere from $15,600 to $31,200. Most likely more given that the end product is much purer than the standard nickel mining products. For comparison, the worldwide production of rice in 2016, which was the highest grossing food crop, was worth $332 billion. And the total acreage dedicated to rice that year was 162 million hectares. So the average value obtained per hectare of rice fields was roughly $2,000. Of course, this comparison doesn't take into account the cost of processing the bio-ore, but it still shows the economic potential behind being able to use agro-mining as a source of nickel. As I said, agro-mine isn't a commercial scale operation just yet, and they'll still need to do more studies and field experiments to optimize everything and maximize yield before committing to full-scale production. However, we can still use our results to estimate how much nickel we could get out of the ground using agro-mining. Assuming a yield of 193 kilograms per hectare, and considering that Europe has over 1 million hectares of available ultramafic soil where we could plant hyperaccumulators, we're looking at 193 million kilograms or 193,000 metric tons of nickel in Europe alone. This isn't a meager sum, knowing that Europe's total nickel production in 2021 was 243,500 tons. So the important takeaway here is that agro-mining has the potential to complement current metal mining. In cases like nickel, the contribution to the global supply chain could be significant if this is deployed on a large scale. It could really help EVs overcome the hurdles that they're going to face in the future. But beyond that, the agro-mining secondary benefit like soil remediation and industrial waste recycling has the potential to take mining to the next level and close the loop in the circular economy. But of course, as you know, nothing is ever perfect, not even agro-mining. First, there's the issue of invasive species. We have thousands of metal hoarding plants to choose from, but we need to choose one that won't compete with and replace indigenous plants in the region, else they would invade and take over the entire ecosystem and cause collapses down the line. Second, even though we've identified thousands of them, we don't know enough about most of the hyperaccumulator species to be able to reproduce and successfully grow these plants in any farm. We still need more agronomic research to optimize things like metal uptake, growth, biomass yield, pest resistance, and more. Finally, there's a problem of depth. Through traditional mining, we can access minerals buried thousands of feet in the ground. However, agro-mining is limited to how deep the roots of the hyperaccumulated plants can go, and these will rarely go deeper than a couple of feet, leaving plenty of untapped metals beneath the ground. But regardless of these cons, what I find most exciting and interesting about the concept behind agro-mining is the possibility of an additional primary source of key metals like nickel, manganese, and others, increasing our economically available reserves without pushing the prices up. Since the total available resources are limited, we still need to improve recycling in a much more reliable secondary source for most metals, but agro-mining buys us more time between what we have now and what we'll need in 10 or 20 years, helping us avoid unnecessary supply chain bottlenecks that'll make transitioning to a cleaner carbon-neutral world harder. It's kind of like one of those ideas behind e-fuels in the sense that they're a promising technology that can serve as a bridge to a more sustainable future. So when you eat a tomato and people say it's good for you, or a banana has potassium, well, that is the plant sucking those nutrients out of the ground up into the roots and into the stem, into the fruit, into the leaves. And that's kind of how all plants work. But what's really interesting is how much of an impact agro-mining specific crops can make. And yes, it is kind of a big deal. And honestly, I'm not so sure if it's a bridge technology or maybe the future, because there's so many areas where the concentration is just too low for any kind of mining practicality. But grow these plants, especially if water is not a concern, and this might make sense. Of course, water is a concern increasingly in more parts of the world. So that really is the one question I still would have. And I would love to reach out to one of these companies in the future to figure out, well, how, when you do these calculations, how do you know how much water these crops will take? And how does that factor into the feasibility study? So this is still new, but I will keep looking into it. And if there's any progress that comes up, we'll make future videos covering this stuff. All right, guys, thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe if you're new, hit that like button and the bell icon to get notifications and stuff. And check out this video next. I think you're going to like. I'm Ricky. This is Tuba Da Vinci.